Hello viewers, today we are going to learn about microwave antennas on transport engineer's perspective. Before going into the index, let's learn about antennas 1. The antenna is a passive device, so you need an electric circuit to illuminate the antenna. Keeping that in our mind, we will go through the index and then we will see more about the antennas. Antenna gain. In the antenna gain, we are going to learn about what is the gain, what are the formulas used to calculate the gain, and front to back ratios. And the second one is the beam width. What are the characteristics of beam width and pros and cons of the beam width? In polarization, we are going to see the types of polarization and the expeding. In antenna noise, we are going to see what are all the parameters which affects the antenna noise and what is the relationship between the antenna noise and the noise figure and noise temperature. In antenna towers, we are going to see the type of antennas and which is suitable for microwave communications and how to calculate the antenna tower heights. And in the horn antenna, which is also called as high performance antenna, we are going to see how it's going to work and what are all the advantages of having a horn antenna. And then finally, in the class 4 antenna, we are going to see the advantages of our class 4 antenna. And the class 4 antenna was introduced by ETSI group, which is more advanced than the class 3 antennas. Okay, let's move on to the subject. Microwave antenna types. Predominantly, the microwave world uses two different types of antennas. One is parabolic antenna, the another one is the horn antenna. The parabolic antenna covers having the size of 0.5 meter to 36 meters, and the horn antenna is the size of the horn antenna is measured in terms of wavelengths. The parabolic antenna covers the traditional microwave frequency of 2 gigahertz to 38 gigahertz. Nowadays we moved into millimeter wave technologies, and the parabolic antenna also covers the V band, W band, and the E band also. If we comes to the horn antenna's frequency range is starting from 300 MHz to 30 GHz. Though we have two different type of antenna, parabolic antenna is widely used across microwave communications. Antenna gain. So what is antenna gain? Before going into antenna gain, let's see what is a waveguide. Waveguide is a device which used to transmit the electromagnetic waves from one medium to another medium. So if a waveguide has to travel from one medium to another medium, the impedance should be matched in the both the mediums. So the waveguide matches the impedance of the free space impedance. Then only the electromagnetic waves comes out of the waveguide and gets reflected in the parabolic surface and moves in the forward direction. The maximum energy of your microwave beam is lying on the both side, so which is also called as a 3 dB margin. And what is the antenna gain? Antenna gain is defined as a formula like 20 log base 10 8.1 df into df, and the unit for measuring the antenna gain is dB. So antenna gain is nothing but the ability of the antenna to focus the beam in a narrow direction. So this is also called as directionality. So traditionally there is a myth that antenna gain is nothing but output by input. Since antenna is a passive device, we can't say that the gain is equal to output by input. So it is a measure of an antenna to focus the beam on a particular direction. By looking at the formula, we come to a conclusion that D is equal to diameter of the antenna, F is the frequency of the microwave link, which is in gigahertz. So if you increase the diameter of the antenna gain is also increased. So you have a more narrow beam width and the directionality is very much higher. And the frequency, if you increase the frequency, you have a higher gain. So that's why you can play around with these two parameters. When you don't have a space in the tower and still if you want a high gain antennas, then go for a higher frequency, which will increase the antenna gain. Okay, what is an omnidirectional antenna? An isotropic antenna which radiates the microwave energy or electromagnetic energy in all the directions is called as the omnidirectional antenna. practical, theoretically, the gain of the omnidirectional antenna should be 1. Okay, directionality, we have seen that the antenna gain is called as a directionality, and the efficiency. Usually, the antenna, microwave antenna's efficiency should be 100%, but practically, it's not 100%. Why? Because the parabolic surface is not in a parabolic, it's not perfect parabolic. And the second one is the imperfect illumination of the waveguide. These two things causes the efficiency lies between the range of 60 to 70 dBs. Imperfect, okay. And the side lobe, this imperfect illumination and the imperfect parabolic surfaces causes the side lobes of the antenna. Okay, if you want to reduce the side lobes, what are all the things we have to do it now? So, then the next parameters, front to back ratio. Front to back ratio is nothing but the ratio between the forward power to the backward power. Forward power is the bore side power. Backward power is the power radiated in the side lobes. So, obviously, we need a high front to back ratio so that the antenna will be better used for a microwave communication, and it's used for a longer hops also. Okay, beam width. What is the beam width? It is the width of the beam. What you would like, would you like a narrow beam width or a wider beam width? Yes, obviously, you like a narrow beam width only. Why? Because it can be able to travel a long distance. Second, it will not interfere with the other beams. So you always prefer the narrow beam width. If you want a narrow beam width, what you have to do? The formula is pi equal to the beam width equal to 21.3 divided by f and d. F is the frequency of the microwave link and d is the diameter of the antenna. So in meters and frequency is in gigahertz. So if you increase the frequency, the beam width will be very narrow. If you increase the diameter of the antenna, the beam width will be very narrow. So this is the funda of having a very narrow beam width. So that's why 0.3 meter is having a wider beam width, which is not used in the longer communications. So what is the pros and cons of having a narrow beam width? So what the advantages is low interference. The second one is the longer hops. Third one, because it is having a high signal to noise ratio, you can increase the modulation, and finally you can increase the capacity also. And the disadvantages is tough alignment. Since the beam width is very narrow, it is very you need a high skills to align the particular microwave link. And the second one is the link availability. If the tower shakes due to high wind speed, then the microseconds or a milliseconds. So it affects the link availability also. Polarization. We all know that there is two different type of polarization. One is vertical polarization, another one is a horizontal polarization. How we define this vertical and horizontal? For example, the feeder. The feeder has been positioned in two different types. One is vertically we can position it, and horizontally we can position it with respect to the ground. Okay, if the feed on is vertically positioned with respect to the ground, then the electric field will be in the horizontal polarization, horizontal. So it is called as horizontal polarization. If the feed on is positioned horizontally with respect to the ground, then the electric field will be in vertical. So it is called as the vertical polarization. For example, in a horizontally polarized waves, some energy is transferred into the horizontally vertical polarization. So the unwanted polarization is called as the cross polarization discrimination. That is called as the XPD. So the unwanted polarization lies in the range of 30 to 40 dBs. Normally, vertical polarization is preferred for the longer hops. Why? Because the rain attenuation is high in the horizontal polarization compared to the vertical polarization. So, in urban areas, people mostly use the horizontal polarization, and in the rural areas, we use the vertical polarization. Okay, antenna noise. What are all the factors which creates the antenna noise, and what is the relationship between the noise figure and the noise temperature? Both are different parameters. So let's see what are all the things which cause the antenna noise. The loss between the antenna and the receiver input, the noises from the sky noise, the galaxy and sun, atmospheric from absorption by the atmospheric gases like O2 and hydroxyl ions, which used to absorb the electromagnetic waves, and the radiation from the earth into the back loops of the antennas. So normally the beam, main beam, the boresight beam usually travels in the vertical, horizontally to the ground, but the side lobes used to travel to in the vertical direction, which was affected by the earth. And the final one then is the interference from the man-made radio resources like vehicle pollution, all these things which comes under the man-made radio resources. So the relationship between the noise figure and noise temperature is 1 dB is equal to 75 K. Okay, let's move on to the horn antennas. Horn antennas is not widely used in the microwave communication, but it's having a higher, it is having a lot of advantages over the parabolic antenna. Let's see what is horn antennas. Horn antenna is actually a waveguide which is used to illuminate another antenna, for example, a parabolic antenna. And then it is used as a feed antenna for another antenna. So it is acting like a waveguide. And then it works in the ultra high frequencies and in the microwave frequencies also. It is having every antenna, every microwave antenna should have a high gain, high front to back ratio, and lower VSWR. So what is VSWR, voltage standing wave ratio? For example, there are three different elements are there in the microwave communication. One is the power source, and the power source is connected to the transport lines, and then the transport lines connects to the load. So if energy has to flow through all the elements, then the impedance should be matched with all the elements. Here the power source is the radio circuit, transmission lines is a copper cable, and the load is an antenna. So if all the impedance are matched with each other, then the wave will perfectly transfer. The 100% of the waves will be transferred in the free space. But actually, practically, it is not possible due to the imperfections, imperfection in the impedances. Some of the wave gets reflected in the three elements and comes back to the source. Because of that, there will be peaks and valleys in the voltage. We can observe the voltage fluctuation in the source side. So voltage standing wave ratio should be the measure of or the ratio of voltage maximum to the voltage minimum. Usually the voltage standing wave ratio for an ideal link should be 1. So normally we can't able to achieve 1. So due to a lot of imperfections in the impedances, it goes beyond 1. So if you have a lower VSWR, then if it is less than 1, it is having a it is better than the other antennas. Excellent side lobe suppressions. Side lobe suppression can be avoided in a parabolic antenna by placing a material called shroud around the parabolic surfaces. And often you can see a plastic surface that is called as random, which is pasted against the shroud, which is used for the weather protection. So here in the horn antennas, the side lobe is very much limited and compared to the parabolic antennas. Usable bandwidth. As we saw, the horn antennas is working in the range of 300 megahertz to 30 gigahertz. The impedance varies very small for the every frequency changes. So that is why it is used in a higher frequency. It covers higher frequencies, higher frequency ranges, and it's also having a higher bandwidth. Multiple frequencies can be transmitted in the same horn antennas. Okay, coming back to the antenna towers. Antenna towers, there are two different type of towers out there. One is self-supporting towers and the second one is the guide tower. Self-supporting towers the land record for the guide towers is equal to 80% of the tower heights. The cost of self-supporting tower is too high because it has to be more stable during the windy conditions, and it should be very stable during the high windy conditions. when you are constructing an antenna tower, you have to see the local soil conditions, and then the wind loading factor also comes into picture. Okay. Imbalance antenna installation in a tower will cause an outage. If antenna started shaking, if you are using a higher diameter antenna or a higher frequency waves, which is having a narrow beamwidth, it will go to misalignment, and obviously it results in an outage. Okay, EARP. What is EARP? Effective isotropic radiated power. So it is actually a transmitter, radio circuit, which transmits the IF frequency in the IF cable, and finally it eliminates the antenna. So what is the power radiated from the antenna? That is called as the EARP. The EARP is calculated as transmit power minus transmit cable loss plus the gain of the antenna. Okay. And finally, we are moving into class 4 antennas. For example, if there is a road and you, for a particular 1 kilometer road, and in 10 minutes duration, you have to push a lot of cars in the road, then what is the solution for that? One, you have a wider road. Second one is, if you increase the speed of the car, you can push more number of cars in the road for a particular duration of the same time. Okay, the same thing applies to the class 4 antennas also. Class 4 antennas is suitable for extremely high interference potential areas. So, particularly used in the urban areas. Since it works very well in the high interference areas, you can use the larger bandwidth. For example, you can use 40 megahertz bandwidth, 50 megahertz or 60 megahertz bandwidth. If you increase the bandwidth, you have a higher capacity in the microwave link. So second one, okay, you don't have a bandwidth of 40 megahertz or 50 megahertz in that case, but I have a very good high signal to noise ratio when I'm using a class 4 antenna. Since I have a higher signal to noise ratio, we can increase the speed of the car. That is nothing but increasing the modulation. If you increase the modulation, obviously you will get a better throughput and better capacity also. And finally, class 4 antennas are smaller antennas and compared to the other class 3 antennas. So wherever there is a limitations in the towers, you can go for a class 4 antennas. That's all, users. Thank you for watching. Have a nice day.